Tonight, the Carter-Jenkins Center will continue with the part three of the series on the development of the self and the object concepts in humans. At the very beginning, in lecture one, I mentioned that this was an extraordinarily neglected subject in psychoanalysis, which indeed it is. Interestingly enough, I received an email recently from a friend and colleague in Venezuela, a psychoanalyst, Dr. Romulo Lander. He has published a book called The Logic of the Object. And in there he reviews some of this concept from a different angle. I'm taking the concept of self and object in the developmental sense from the black screen with which the infant is born to how it gradually he constructs and builds an image of himself that gets modified until finally it acquires the final, more or less final characteristic that it should have. And the same in terms of the object, how from that blank screen and the development of the self after the primary narcissistic stage, the cathexis move outside to the objects and the development of object relationships that we discussed in the second lecture begins. Dr. Lander's book has a large number of chapters, and it seems to review the views of Melanie Klein, Bion, Spitz, and a variety of other people that have discussed it from a different angle. Tonight we are going to deal with the primitive primary narcissistic self stage. We describe at the end of the previous lecture how a primitive self, mostly a bodily self or a body self, got organized. This was possible thanks to the gradual development of the ego and of its cognitive abilities, partly related to the physical maturation of the brain as well and the myelinization that we describe, and partly because it's being subjected to a stimuli that act as a growth nutriment as well as giving an opportunity to acquire practice and exercise skills to accumulate knowledge and to organize structures in the mind. All of this has to take place very gradually and through extensive periods of time. I believe that this primitive primary narcissistic self stage is generally reached around the third month of life. But this is just the very beginning of the stage, which itself continues at least up to the end of the first year of life, or a little later, 12 to 15 months of age. This phase that I describe here as a primitive primary narcissistic self stage coincides roughly with Freud's stage of primary narcissism and precedes the stage of object relations. As you remember from the previous lecture, this is, in terms of the divisional positions, and at the beginning there is the phase of autoerotism that is superseded by the phase of primary narcissism, that then the awareness of the existence of things in the outside, the subject self that gratify his needs without which he can quite regain the homeostatic equilibrium, start to withdraw cathexis to the self, and then that's the beginning of object relationship. Then when the self become sufficiently developed and sends the cathexis to the objects in sufficient quantities, then the object becomes important and can return this cathexis in various forms, love, attention, care, tenderness, praise to the child, and so on, and this constitutes the secondary narcissistic cathexis. But that is already when the object has acquired a status of its own and a significance of great importance. During this stage of primary narcissism, the activity of the component instinct and erotogenic zones as manifested through autoerotic activities no longer occurs as isolated manifestation of tension and discharge phenomena taking place in a random fashion anywhere in the body and totally independent of each other, as it was the case in the face of autoerotism. The limited awareness and lack of organization typical of the previous phase, the autoerotic phase, autoerotism phase, is now gradually being modified. Some degree of differentiation and structuralization is taking place, and this leads in the direction of the first step in the organization and formation of a self-image, particularly a body image component of the self-image. This constitutes the beginning of what we acknowledge to be one of the functions of the ego, that is, the establishment and maintenance of the self. Indeed, the development of the body image marks at the same time the very beginning of the ego as an organized system. The ego, Freud used to say, is first and foremost a bodily ego. And that was a statement from the U on the Id in 1923. It should be noted that with this beginning of a structuralization, the autoerotic activities, manifestation of excitation of the component instinct and erotogenic zones, occur in a new referential frame, that of the body image. They are not isolated, they now take place in the body image as now known and recognized, and it's still primitive, it gradually develops and refines itself. It is for this reason that the impingement of tension caused by the drive for component instinct looking for gratification in an autoerotic manner or the painful stimuli can no longer be easily viewed or felt as an attack from outside the basic original feeling state. During the first stage, the child can affect only the experiences of pleasure and pleasure, and the memory traces that are formed out of these various experiences. The degree of organization of the mind and the lack of a body image of a concept of the self make it impossible during this first stage, the autoerotic non-self, non-object stage, to cathect the body. There is no body to cathect in the psychological sense of the word, in the mind of the child. There is only the experience of the moment. at least that part of the body that brings about the pleasurable sensation. The cathexis go to the experience itself in that first part. This brings to mind some borderline children who do not recognize objects, but the functions that they perform for them or the experience these objects provide them with. They refer to the therapist, for example, some of the children as the therapy, not as the therapist, but the therapy. And to the lady that provides orange juice as the orange juice lady. You see, very concrete. Yet, at a little later, by the second stage, that is the primitive, primary, narcissistic self that we are discussing now, when the beginning of the self is already present, the body, particularly that part of it involved in the experience of pleasure, can be cathected, since it can now be identified by the mental apparatus as a pleasurable part of itself. I say pleasurable because it seems possible that at least early during the second stage of the primitive narcissistic self, there is still the tendency to this own unpleasurable feelings. At some point, a little later on, even the unpleasurable or painful sensations will have to be acknowledged and contained as belonging into the child's self. Otherwise, the establishment and development of reality testing will be permanently interfered with. This will also be true of the necessary shift from functioning according to the pleasure principle to functioning according to the reality principle, which is an extraordinarily important step in development. I believe Freud, in 1914, had this type of phenomena in mind when he noted, quote, that a unity comparable to the ego cannot exist in the individual from the very start. The ego has to be developed. The autoerotic instincts, however, are there from the very first, so there must be something added to autoerotism, a new psychical action, in order to bring about narcissism. That's the end of the quote. Furthermore, now that this tension and consequently the given autoerotic activity, for example, are identified with one's own body, the body is recognized as the me and as that which yields the pleasure, thus making it possible for the infant to cathect it. And this will occur increasingly so. It is thus that Freud's stage of primary narcissism is reached. The position of the libido is now in the self, not in the autoerotic activity itself. It is referred to the self where that autoerotic excitement is taking place. A stage that coincides with my stage that I'm describing now, the primitive primary narcissistic self. The concept of the self and the body image take a long time to evolve. They are first quite distorted and far from accurate representations of one's actual physical and psychical reality. One's actual physical and psychical reality can only be known better, never completely, at a much later developmental stage. Indeed, we should add that the self never remains static. On the contrary, it is modified all through life, though certain aspects of it may have some degree of permanence from very early on. The concept of the self changed significantly through life. It is clear that the nature of the stimuli that now impinges on the mental apparatus and the processes that handle this information, this sensation, this stimuli, etc., have become much more psychologically significant and meaningful than they were before at the earlier autoerotic, non-self, non-object stage. For the infant to maintain this stage of primary narcissism and its accompanying homeostasis, as well as for the self to continue to evolve, the infant is nearly totally dependent on the external environment. Thus, during the first autoerotic non-self, non-object stage, and the second primitive primary narcissistic self stages, the mother as a child's biological object fulfilled a large number of the essential functions required by the child. She acts as a barrier, for example, against undesirable or excessive stimuli of the infant, and is the provider of all of his essential physical needs. She is the most important regulating factor in the constant struggle for the recovery of the basic, original, homeostatic, eupathic feeling, which is forever being disturbed by external and internal stimulation. She provides, too, innumerable forms of stimulation and forms of body contact, which are essential as an important contribution for the normal development of the infant, indeed, for the normal maturation of the brain. These are all required ingredients for the development of the body image and, as such, of a healthy self as time goes on. When the mother fails in providing these essential functions for the infant, there are significant problems in the development of the body image and the self image. Her role as a triggering and releasing agency of many other processes, furthering drive and ego development, can never be underestimated. With the increasing development, where the increasing delineation of the body image and the self that takes place during this stage, the outside, not self, or not me, becomes quite distinct from the self gradually. This distinction is of great significance, but it doesn't imply that the child can clearly distinguish where in the not self, the not me or external world, different things belong. This type of process starts early and proceeds very slowly during this second stage. From this point onward, and due to his further ego development, experiencing and learning during the 9 months or more of this stage, he embarked on the long and arduous task of coming to understand not only some of the constituent elements of his external world, but also of the interaction between it and the primitive self. Of course, the non-self, that is the external world at this point, is only vaguely hinted at the beginning of this process. Yet, it defined as it is in the child's mind, these vague hints of an outside help considerably influenced the further and more precise delineation of the primitive primary narcissistic self stage by gradually excluding certain things and including others. Given the dominant role that his mother plays in his life as the most significant element of that essentially unknown external world, it is natural that from a given time onwards he would develop, at first in a very obscure manner and later more precisely, an increasing psychological interaction and awareness of her existence, and her essential function. In this way, she begins to draw larger and larger amounts of cathexis and interest, a fact that we have referred to early on in this lecture. When this shift has acquired sufficient momentum, we arrive at that stage that Freud described as a stage of object relation, signifying that the libidinal position has shifted again. It's not now in the self, it has gone to cathect the world of objects. In other words, from cathecting only the self, libidinal cathexis now move outside the self to the external world and its still ill-defined objects. In terms of the development of the self, we arrive at what I would describe as the interaction of self and other quasi-object stage, the final outcome of which will be the development of proper object, well-developed relationships. Let's now look at the third point, the interaction of self and other quasi-object stage, but not completely developed object stage. The beginning of the type of phenomena that characterizes this stage has to be looked for early in the previous phase we have described so far. But at that time, it occurs only as occasional, single, isolated manifestations that do not get linked to one another. In other words, they are like questions with different, closely interrelated contents posed to the mentational abilities of the child at different moments in time. They tend to contradict the achieved status quo, posing conceptual problems that puzzle the infant, problems that he must answer satisfactorily at some later date as he matures, learns, and develops. As many of these original, isolated events acquire more specific meaning in the child's mind, one that is closer to its real meaning, many of them gel together. In this new light, they acquire significance in terms of the correlation and relatedness. Slowly but surely, as that happens, new understandings develop. The process further permits the infant to dissect from aspects of the self things that do not in actuality belong to it, but that were assimilated to it by virtue of the global nature of the sensory motor experience of the young infant and of his limited capacity for fine discrimination among the constituent elements of any given sensorial experience. Similarly, certain things that were originally stereotyped because of their painful or unpleasurable nature must now be accepted as part of the self at some point. In any case, many events, happenings, and so on make it clear to the young infant that certain aspects of it cannot really be placed on the self as they were before, when mentation was more primitive and less discriminatory, so that they belong somewhere else, on that vague outside of the self that is starting to materialize, but that remains imprecise and obscure at the beginning. An example of what I have in mind here is the fact that young infants can recognize certain people, and that these so recognized are different from others, according to Spieth, René Spieth, who believe that this is possible from the 3rd month onward. Piaget, on the other hand, thinks that it happens from the 5th week onwards. But as Piaget points out, we cannot for this reason assume that the infant has any notion of a person or of an object. All he is recognizing is certain animated sensory perceptions, but this proves nothing regarding their substantiality or regarding a separation between him and the external world and the object world. Piaget adds a little later in his book that it is easy to demonstrate that early on the infant does not perceive objects, things, or human, properly speaking. He does recognize certain familiar sensorial pictures, but the recognition, while they are sensorially present, is not at all equivalent with placing them in some place. That is, not at all equivalent with, as I said, with placing them somewhere. That is, without, with the being substantial and somewhere, when they are outside of the perceptual field. In other words, if they are not in his visual field, they disappear. Yet, there can be no question that at such point there has been a change already of some kind in the child's perception, and that is a kind of new obscure awareness of something out there, which has no permanence and no substance of its own and tends to disappear when you move out of the field of vision. This is, one could say, a first but incomplete step in the direction of further differentiation that will continue to take place gradually. According to Piaget too, there are 4 fundamental processes that characterize the intellectual revolution of the first 2 years of life of the infant. They are all very highly relevant to our subject here. But for our purposes, I will discuss only one of them. I refer to the construction of the category of objects, that is, the concept of objects. The idea's use of the term object may refer to either things or humans. It is usually clear in what follows which he is referring to, whether humans or something else. Frequently, I will leave, or I will remark, when that happens, to avoid possible confusion when he refers to any specific case, either a thing or an object. This awareness or recognition is a necessary prerequisite to the permanent cathexis of objects, to genuine, in the full psychological cognitive sense, choice of objects and object relationships. Early on in life, the concept of object is only a practical category related to pure action, that is, it's a sensorimotor type of coordination and sensation, and does not as yet take the form of a thought or a thinking notion. This concept of practical category, once fully established, a process that takes up to the first 18 months of life, it is characterized by the substantial permanence that is attributed by the infant to the sensorial picture. Now, even if it is not in the visual field, it has an existence in the mind of the child. That is, the infant has developed a concept according to which their perceived figure corresponds to something that will continue to exist even when one is not perceiving it any longer. As I said, this awareness or recognition is a fundamental prerequisite to the permanent cathexis of objects. To genuine, in the full psychological cognitive sense, choice of objects and to the development of object relationships. Indeed, according to Piaget, it is not until 9 to 12 months of age that the infant clearly shows a searching behavior for objects that move out of his perceptual field. And here he refers to both things and objects. Objects have become permanent and substantial. They are somewhere out there, though not seen at the moment. So he's now actively, between the 9th and the 12th month, showing a searching behavior, even when the objects move outside of the perceptual field. As Piaget says, they are somewhere out there, though they are not seen at that particular moment. Now, it is precisely this criterion that allows us to recognize the beginning of the exteriorization of the material world, a step in the elaboration of this external universe for the child. In other words, a consciousness of the self starts to develop as an internal subjective polar reality, in contrast and opposition to that other external and objective polar of reality constituted by the external world and its components, which has many and various human things, animals, etc. Given the importance of the concept of the object in psychoanalysis and all the formulations that are derived from it, and given that it is generally agreed that before that stage what gets affected is a particularly sensory motor experience only, the object being part of the nature and going unrecognized by itself, it may be valuable to examine briefly once more Piaget's views about the construction of that concept by the infant from the very beginning of his extra-uterine life. Thus, Piaget believes that the object concept is not innate, as we have repeatedly said, but must be acquired. In other words, the idea that objects are more or less permanent and substantial, and that they are not destroyed when they disappear from the infant's perceptive field, is not an inherited characteristic, not something that the child is born with that kind of knowledge. He had to develop it. He thinks that an awareness, Piaget thinks, an awareness of objects will develop out of the infant's sensory motor experience very gradually during the first year of life. Thus, the infant has to construct for himself the external world and the universe of objects, things and humans, through his own experiences, repeated experiences. During the first month of life, then, the infant has no object concept at all. Objects, in inverted commas, coming in contact with him are, as Wadsworth then said, quoting Piaget, merely something to suck, to grasp, or to look at, and this evokes only an undifferentiated reflexive response. But remember, out of sight, out of mind. At this point, during Piaget stage two, which is the stage that go from the first to the fourth month, the child develops an awareness of objects that was not present during the first stage, that is, during the first month. Thus, he can focus on objects and track an object moving through his field of vision. Further, he can now turn to look at the objects he hears, showing the coordination between vision and hearing. But remember that none of this happens before the third month, because it requires the malignization of the pyramidal way, so he can control his head and look in a 180 degrees perspective. The infant doesn't have either the concept of the constancy of the shape and forms of objects, so that when the object is seen from a new angle or at a different distance between subject and object, this is not understood as a change in perspective, but an actual change in the size and the form of the object. It's like if it were a different object. There are still no signs of any active searching for objects in this second stage. And in this case, we mean things, and I'll give you an example of what I mean in a moment. When the desired object is covered, for example, with a handkerchief, even when the infant has carefully followed with his eyes every one of the movements made in hiding the object, he doesn't search for it. Out of sight, out of mind. During stage 3, which is 4 to 8 months, the infant is capable of anticipating the positions objects will pass through while they are moving in perceptive fields. Since he knows where the object will be in the trajectory before it gets there, it will seem that in some as yet obscure and very primitive way, he is developing a sense of the permanence of the object. During this stage, the infant starts to acquire the ability to distinguish between movements of the object and those of his own body, something that he was not able to do before. In contrast then with the previous phase, which such distinction was impossible for him. It is in this distinction, actually, that the beginning of the searching for objects when they disappear is to be found, according to Piaget and in Helder, his collaborator. As they say, quote, "It is in terms of this grouping of movements and the permanence attributed to the object that the latter acquire fixed dimensions and its size is estimated more or less correctly, regardless of whether it is near or is distant, or is even seen from a different angle. By the end of stage 3, that is, by the end of the 8th month, infants can anticipate the position in which falling objects, things, in this case, will rest, thus demonstrating a better knowledge of some aspects of their behavior, but there is still no active searching behavior for objects that are hidden in front of their eyes. By stage 4, 8 to 12 months, the infant then definitely acquires the concept of the constancy of the shape and size of the object. Notice how long it takes. According to Piaget and Heller, by 8 or 9 months he really explores the perspective effects of actual displacement. It is at this stage that a new dimension in the object concept develops. Up to this point, if an object such as a rattle, which he loves, infants love, is hidden under a handkerchief while the infant looks, he doesn't search for it. But now, he actively searches for and retrieves the rattle hidden under the handkerchief of the blanket. To do this, the infant has to acquire the concept that objects continue to exist after they disappear from perception. In this case is that things continue to exist when they disappear from perception. Nevertheless, at this point, the infant only searches for the object when it generally disappears, and not necessarily when he saw it disappear this last time. Thus, he had no ability to understand what Piaget called sequential displacements. For a certain amount of time, he will look under the place where he saw the object disappear early on, to this last time it may have disappeared in a different place under the handkerchief, the blanket in front of his eyes. In Piaget's stage 6, which is 18 to 24 months, the child now moves from the sensory motor level of intelligence, practical intelligence, to representational intelligence. By now, the child can represent events internally, and this newly acquired ability is reflected in the child's object concept, both of things and objects. Thus he can not only find things when he sees them being hidden, but he will search for and find, and in a sequence of places, objects that he does not see being hidden, a fact that shows his liberation from immediate perception. In other words, he's now thinking. The development of this latter skill can in fact be seen as early as the 14 and 15 months of life. In my observation, this is about the time at which the child developed what I told you about early in first lecture and at the end of the second lecture. The child has developed the object constancy vis-a-vis the need satisfaction phase or the stage of development of the child in an appropriate sense of the term. Indeed, it seems quite reasonable to assume that object constancy cannot be developed appropriately before the object can be represented in the child's mind and before the knowledge of its substantial and permanent nature, Albert, is well established. For an excellent discussion of some aspects of the problem that I involve here, you can see the paper by Freiber, Selma Freiber, in 1969. But remember what is meant by object constancy. It means that before he reaches that stage in the 14th, 15th month, sometimes, you know, after the 12th, 13th month onward, of object constancy, that means that the object has acquired relevance, not because of the need it satisfies, but is now important by itself, independent of the need that the object satisfies, which means the beginning of life, in the first few months of life, the change of the object didn't matter much. What mattered was the satisfaction of the need of the child, and the child could accept the substitute relatively easy, with relatively few signs of distress about the change of object, and that's the need satisfaction stage. When he hits the 14 months or thereabouts, he has developed object constancy, which means now the object becomes important by itself, independent of the need that is satisfied. The way I explained it to you before, if he loses that object at this point when he changes, there are clear signs of the distress of the child, and that's a traumatic event that may have consequences for the rest of his life. Now, I have chosen to select this point in development at the beginning of genuine object relations on the following premises. That means that the child has acquired object constancy. There is a sufficient distinction, though not absolutely precise or complete in all respects, between the self and the external world. Still have to be refined. But there is enough of it. There is a sufficient awareness of the relative importance in regard to the self of the various objects identifying the external world at this time, be that things or objects, though that distinction is not absolutely precise and not complete in all respects either. There is a sufficient awareness of the relative importance in regard to the self of the various objects identifying the external world at this time, though that distinction is not absolutely precise and complete in all respects, and that's important. There is sufficient evidence that one object has acquired a particularly significant and relevant position in regard to the self and vis-a-vis the other objects, namely the mother or the mothering person. And that's when he has reached object constancy. That's the first selection of an object is a mother or usual selection objects. And as I mentioned, it'd be quite traumatic if there is a change of that object or that object disappears. That object, the mother general, the mother in person, now drives the most cathexis and interest from the child and has acquired the characteristic and qualities that I describe as object constancy and the child having acquired a primary object, a most important object early on in his life. This formulation consists not only with psychoanalytic theory and psychoanalytic observation, but with the tenets of cognitive development, the development of the concept of the object, the external world, causality, and intentionality as substantiated by Piagetian theory. Now, of course, in all the above, I have referred to the course of normal development, and we are all aware that there are many children that, for one reason or another, perhaps because inappropriate mothers, do not develop object consciousness or only in a limited manner. Similarly, some children do not develop a clear, distinct, and preferred primary object. And there are many reasons for this, including the fact that the interaction between the mother in person and the child is truncated, and there are many caretakers and no constancy of the object. I believe that the large number of reasons that may explain the failures in cognitive development, the development of a clear concept of the self and of the object, the development of object constancy and the attachment to a primary object, are the reasons that underline certain types of psychotic, borderline, narcissistic, and neurotic disturbances, depending on where the defect lies and its severity, how early it took place. It should be clear that with the development of the object concept and its location in the not-me, the external world, and with the resultant and concomitant establishment of object constancy, we have reached a functional and definitional beginning in terms of human object relations. Object constancy implies of necessity a fusion of the good and bad object representation in the sense of Jacobson, Kember, and others, since it means that the child continues to be attached to the object irrespective of the object being good or bad or satisfying the child's needs or not. But this has to be taken as a baseline that can be temporarily obscured by the vicissitude of the multiple interactions between subject and object. In other words, certain aspects of the object behavior may be denied, displaced, or subjected to the vicissitude created by the infant's ambivalence, hostile or aggressive feelings, shifts from love to hate, various drive demands, level of frustration, tolerance, eros and stress, and the like. Thus, the baseline described above gets more or less temporarily submerged or distorted under the weight of one or more of all these possible influences in the course of normal development. If there are important and favorable circumstances of various types, that distortion of submersion may become more permanent, with consequent damage to personality development and possible multiple consequences in terms of later psychopathology. But it is important to realize that the damage does accrue is on the basis of conflictual situations as they arise in the interactions between the subject, drive needs, etc., and the objects. That is quite different from pathology resulting from damage to the actual apparatuses and or cognitive structures for organic, hereditary, or other reasons, or those that are the result of insufficient opportunity to receive a stimuli, like infants in institutions, to practice and to acquire skills, to acquire knowledge, etc., in the process of the interaction with an expectable environment. And that is the end of what I wanted to present this evening. Many thanks for your attention.